years leading up to their coming together to represent our nation as the soccer team for the World Cup, right? They came together and they did an interview in Self magazine with them, and this is what they said. They said that they found that to work out together was far better and made the victories even sweeter because they not only enjoyed it for themselves, but also for their teammates whom they had come to admire and care about. Did you get that? So it was sweeter because they shared it with one another. It wasn't just an individual thing. Paul, in this passage, well, in the previous passages, the first three chapters, we've talked about that. Sorry, Marge, you weren't here. We talked about it, the first three chapters of Ephesians. Paul talks about how great is this salvation and how great is this God who has saved us. We can't even begin to fathom how marvelous He is and what He's given to us and how He has saved us and He's put Himself in us, this great unfathomable God that we can't measure the depth and height and width and length and all that of, is in us. Oh my. I mean, that's just hard to imagine, right? I mean, some part of God is in each of us. But then in this next three chapters, he says, okay, well, I've told you how great it is and who God is and what you have. Guess what? There's some expectations for living that you've got to follow in order to be a part of this family. Right? I mean, you've been given a gracious gift, but there's some things that come with that. Okay, some expectations. Live worthily. Let's see if this will work. And he says, live a life worthy to the call you've been given. Okay, so, and I've run across people, and maybe you have, that you wouldn't know they were Christians, you know? By the words that come out of their mouth, by the way that they live, some of the things they do, but then if you get a chance to talk to them, sometimes they say, oh, I'm saved. I made a public profession of faith when I was 8 years old. I've done that, right? And I was like, well, dude, How do you do this, drinking, partying, chasing women thing and cussing and, all that stuff and living like that? And he's like, well, we're all sinners. We're sinners saved by grace. Really? Is that what it's supposed to be like? Paul would beg to differ with that kind of lifestyle. And I just use that to kind of, illustrate to y'all. There's some expectations for us. There's a Christian writer named Christine Flowers, and here's the other ditch we have an occasion to get in. And this lady said, she writes and syndicated and all that. She says, I've always felt more drawn to the Old Testament than to its sequel because I think judging makes a lot of sense. Oh, wait a minute. We want to be Old Testament Christians, right? We want to be able to whip people with that Ten Commandments and beat them over the head with it and judge people that aren't doing things quite the way we want them to or the way we think it ought to be done. And we have that spiritual gift of criticism, right? Of being a holy critic and jumping on somebody and beating them down, or talking about them. Oh, wait a minute. And sometimes the world sees Christians that way, y'all. We got to be real careful about the image we present to the world, because if you start talking to unchurched people, oftentimes their view of the church is we're a bunch of judgmental hypocrites, that all we want to do is criticize others for the way they're living, and we don't want to look at ourselves. Wait a minute. Uh-oh. Paul says, first of all, we got to be humble and gentle. Humble and gentle. Okay. And I have to be reminded of this. I don't know about y'all. I need to hear this. Your preacher needs to hear this too. Because every now and then your preacher gets on a high horse and gets to thinking he's holier than thou and start getting judgmental on people. Yeah, I fall for that too. I got to admit, it happens, right? That humble and gentle thing isn't something that comes easy for us. And I think part of it is our culture here. It's easier for us to be strong-willed, independent-headed. Well, and God used a word about the Hebrew people he called stiff-necked. That kind of personifies this independent-headedness and wanting to go our own way. But he also says Moses was the most humble man in the world. And he's the one God exalted to lead the nation of Israel. Humble, be humble, humility, patient. I have a hard time being patient at a red light. Do y'all? I mean, really? Golly, I mean, I'm sorry. I mean, I got my thing I got to go do. And even if I don't, okay, even if I'm just lollygagging around, I don't want to wait in a stupid red light. And I've got one red light in particular that I want to get a shotgun to and shoot out. Do y'all know? Is that one on the North Loop going down toward Calvary Baptist? That one kind of the right there where University hit. I want to shoot that light. Because it always turns yellow just as I'm about to get to it. I'm going to have to slam on brakes or either shoot the gas to it. I hate that light. Patience. Oh, my. Mercy, 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 y'all. And what he's trying to say is with each other, we're supposed to exemplify these things with each other. Humble and gentle. Patient. Oh, wait a minute. That's tough, bit. You know, that's... some of y'all remember Lee Iacocca, right? I mean, he was over Chrysler there for a while. He asked Vince Lombardi. Some of y'all may remember Vince Lombardi. He coached the Green Bay Packers to the first Super Bowl championships back in the 60s. All that, I can remember some of the players. but anyway, Bart Stauffer was cool. He asked him what it takes to make a winning team. And here's what he said. He said, there are a lot of coaches with good ball clubs who know the fundamentals and have plenty of discipline but still don't win the game. If you're going to play together as a team, you got to care for one another. You got to love each other. Each player has to be thinking about the next guy and be saying to himself, if I don't block that man, Paul is going to get his legs broke. I have to do my job well in order that he can do his. He said, the difference between mediocrity and greatness is the feeling these guys have for each other.
Wow.
How about that? Wow. I'm reminded also of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. You know, we're told, was it Galatians? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That's a picture of God. If you flip those upside down, you get a picture of the influence of the world. Boom. And that would, you know, you can flip some of love. Instead of love, it's hatred. Instead of joy, it's despair. Instead of peace, it would be chaos and conflict. Instead of patience, it would be impatience. Instead of kindness, it would be meanness, maybe. Anyway, you get the picture. See, God has given you and I the Holy Spirit It's not a trite thing, okay? It's really not. That's the power of God, as he talked about how the breadth of the universe last week and the end of chapter 3 and how high and wide and long and deep and all that God's love is. Boom, it's been poured into you and I, right? Without measure. One thing I will tell you that I've learned about the Holy Spirit is, like my friend who chooses to continue to live as the world lives and say he's a Christian, you have to put forth an effort. God works in harmony with us, okay? We have to be willing to do the hard work too. It's not easy, right? He's not going to do it all for us. He's a perfect gentleman. If you don't want it, he's not going to make you do it. He wants you to work in harmony with him, to take those hard steps to study the Bible. I mean, study Scripture. We don't just get that with salvation and the Holy Spirit. You don't just know the whole Bible. I mean, it's not miraculously given to you in that instant. Okay, let me quote to you Isaiah 42:17. No, it doesn't work like that. You got to do the hard work. You've got to go and read it. You've got to study it. You've got to spend time in prayer, getting close to God. Guess what? You and I can drift away from God if we don't exercise those spiritual disciplines that draw us to God, that kind of empower the Spirit within us. We'll drift away. It'll happen. I promise you. And we will be, rather than a catalyst for unity in the church, we will be the opposite. We will be that starts to tear the church of Christ apart. Instead of working for God, we can end up working for the enemy. Just saying. All right, so live united in the Spirit of God. You and I are called by God to encourage and to be a force for Christ in this world. That's no small thing. It's the greatest thing you and I can ever accomplish. Above everything, above our financial wealth that we may or may not build up, our education, what we give to our kids. If we have to put Jesus into them kids and grandkids too. I mean, we got to do what we can to see that they are raised up to Christ. Okay? Amen. I get an amen on that one?
Amen.
All right. Alexander Solzhenitsyn, some of y'all may, this name may sound familiar to you. He was one of the intellectual elites in Russia back in the post-World War II era, the Cold War era and all that, when Stalin's was cracking down on everybody and anybody that was against him or was critical about what he was doing. And he would send them to concentration camps or, you know, in Siberia, right? Imprisoned them at hard labor. Solzhenitsyn was one of those. He was one of those that was sent away. And one day he felt like giving up. He was tired. He was worn. He'd been there for years. And he just sat down. He just sat down over there on a bench and put his shovel that he'd been using over to the side. And he knew that meant certain death for him. That when the guard saw him, he would come over, and if he wouldn't get up, that he would bludgeon him to death right there where he sat. He knew that was coming. And he says he sat there with his head down. He felt a presence there with him, and he looked beside him, and there was a haggard old man that had no expression on his face and deep lines of age and hard life. Another prisoner had sat down beside him. And that the elderly man took a stick, and in the sand right in front of Solzhenitsyn, he drew the cross. And that breathed new life into Solzhenitsyn. And he said, my whole world just shifted on its axis right then and there. That someone else would sit beside me and that would give me the hope of the world, that would share that hope with me. And he stood up and he went back to his labor. And some of you may know he would end up being set free, and he would ride against the atrocities of the KGB, of Stalinism, and he would end up winning the Nobel Prize for Literature for some of his work. We are that in this world. We are that for one another. This world can beat us down, right? We don't have to be imprisoned in Siberia. We can get in a prison here in Nacogdoches. We need each other. We need each other to give each other encouragement and hope, and to share the hope we all have in us, which is Jesus the Christ. There it goes. All right, there we go. And Paul has this beautiful, poetic closing to this passage, to live as one. That you and I are to live as one. We are one body. We are together, the body of Christ. You and I are. We have the one Spirit, the Spirit of God living in each of us. We have one hope, which is in our salvation that's given freely to us. We have one Lord, whose name is Jesus Christ. We don't serve many lords. We serve one Lord. And this Lord was risen from the dead. He is like no other. Not like Allah, not like Buddha, not like Muhammad, not like Krishna. None of them have risen from the dead. Christ alone has paid the price for our sins and has won the victory over sin and death for us. We have one Lord, and we also have one faith. And that's the faith in this risen Christ. And we celebrate one baptism. Now, one baptism, and some have taken to believe, in the Methodist Church takes it to believe, you only get baptized once, okay? And if that's as an infant, then that's it. And that's okay. But it's, I think symbolically, it means we're all baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. There's no baptism by multiple means or multiple, well, if you've been baptized three times, a dozen times, you're still baptized as a Christian, right? Into the one faith. Whether you were submerged, sprinkled, or somebody used a water gun. Okay? It's all the same. It's one baptism. It's one in Christ. And he goes further and says, we have one God and Father who's over all. Remember that imagery of the whole universe? He's over all the universe. That's pretty big, right? And then he says he's in all. Overall, he's in all. He's in everything. He's everywhere. There's nowhere you can go to escape God. He's everywhere. If they blasted us off in a rocket that went past the end of the furthest solar system, God would still be there. And he would be in us. He's overall, in all, and living through all. He's living through us, mysteriously. I'm reminded of the word synergy. Y'all ever heard of that word, synergy? It's like, okay, we all do our best individually, okay, and whatever accomplishments we make or contribute, we bring them all together, we put them in a pile, okay, and that's pretty good, right? But that's just individual accomplishments, individual contributions added together. Synergy is where we all work together, and somehow, because of our working together, we can accomplish far more than each of us working individually and putting it all in a pile. It's what God does. It's what God does when He works in His body. It's synergistic, and not only just that dynamic of us working together can do far greater than we could individually. Throw the Spirit of God in there, and anything could be accomplished. We could change this community of Central Heights. We could change Nacogdoches if we pooled ourselves together and the Spirit of God got in the middle of it. Great things could be accomplished for God. But remember, you've got to be humble and gentle and patient. Exercise the fruit of the Spirit, not some of those other fruits that we like to kind of claim along the way. Okay, the U.S. Women's National Soccer Team. Well, they worked together, they worked out together, they lived together, they shared life together, they practiced and worked hard together, they won together. They won the World Cup this year. Yay. And they got a ticker tape parade in Manhattan. I mean, that's not everybody gets one of those. Pretty rare. So they got the ticker tape parade treatment in Manhattan. Todd Gurley's going to be active today, looks like. I just got an update for my fantasy football. Maybe I'll put this thing on airplane mode so I don't get all these updates. Anyway. So, what Paul is trying to say in a nutshell is, y'all, we got to work together. We got to work in harmony with each other and let God use us to accomplish His purpose. I don't know necessarily what that is all the time, okay? I'll admit. And there's times I need to step back and let somebody else be in charge. Well, we ultimately always need to let God be in charge, right?
Amen.
I mean, we need to humble ourselves before Him and allow Him to be the one who leads us. And I, for one, let myself get in the way sometimes. I don't know about y'all. But Paul says we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. May we continue to look to Him as somehow supernaturally the God of the God that made the universe can use us. I mean, isn't that mind-blowing? When He's chosen to use you and I to carry the message about His saving grace, about His love for everybody. Wow. That's amazing that He would care. That He would want to involve us, you know, frail vessels that we are. And yeah, we all struggle. Yeah. We all struggle. But don't give up. And don't let the old flesh win the victory, okay? Let's continue to repent. Sometimes we need to repent and confess stuff and get beyond it and go forward and trust in the Lord and let Him lead us. And you know what? Somehow we'll accomplish far greater together with God's help than we could ever do as Lone Ranger Christians sitting in the house watching Joel Osteen on Sunday morning, right? Nothing wrong with that, every now and then, but you know what? We need each other. This was God's plan. It wasn't Rick Anderson's plan. This was God's plan, okay? So. All right, I'm gonna shut up. All right, we're.